Hello and welcome everyone. It's my pleasure to introduce Ling Zhou, who will be speaking to us about the persistent homotopy groups of metric spaces.
Thank you, John. It's my pleasure to give the talk at the BAQT workshop, and this is John with my advisor Facundo Memoli. One of our motivation to study persistent homotopy groups is the following. So in 1999, in a paper by Gromov, he mentioned a short story where he met two topologists and he asked them the same question, whether the universe is simply connected. It turns out he got different answers, and that motivates him to think maybe there is a better question to ask. That is, how simply connected a space is, instead of asking whether it is simply connected. So just look at this figure. We have a huge sphere with a very tiny handle. Of course, it's not simply connected, but it makes sense to think this space is almost simply connected. And one part of our study is to give an answer to this question. Let's move to the main part. And I want to start by giving a brief review of some of the previous work that combines persistence with homotopy. So this there is a paper by Frosny and Mullenzeni in 1999. The authors uses persistent fundamental groups to estimate the differences between two manifolds, and they introduced the notion called natural size distance, and which is in particular useful when measuring the manifolds that are differ by a rescaling, and they use persistent fundamental groups to estimate that notion of distance. And there are some more works. In 2012, Lester uses the notion of persistent fundamental group and get and develop an environment out of it to study the knotting behavior of a filtration embedded in S3. And there are also many studies that care about the properties of persistent homotopy. For example, Blumberg and Lesnik, they formulated certain persistent Whitehead conjectures, and Batten et al., they studied the persistent versions of Van Kempen theorem, excision theorem, and Huway theorem. Jardine, these are both preprints, and he uses the idea of from poset theory, and he studied Vuittori Ribbs complexes associated to data sets. In particular, he considers the notion called persistent fundamental group point. And my starting point in this project was actually coming from discrete homotopy theory. So my advisor, he proposed this question of me thinking, how can we lift the discrete fundamental groups to a persistent version? And I'm going to introduce our study from that perspective by first mentioning the discrete homotopy theory. And I thank Professor Plott, who has covered part of the introduction for that. In discrete setting, what we do is just discretize everything. Instead of considering continuous loops, you have the notion of discrete loops, and that discretization depends on the scale parameter. Here I'm using T. And there, the usual way to discretize loops is simply taking T Lipschitz maps from a finite set to the metric space we are studying. But there can be different ways to discretize the notion of homotopy. For example, one example is what Professor Plott introduced in the previous talk. And the other example is done by Vassilov's group, where they consider a T homotopy to be a T Lipschitz map from this M by M grid equipped with L1 metric to the metric space. And visually, we can think that a T Lipschitz map corresponds to such a matrix where you require all the vertical, horizontal, and diagonally adjacent points to have distance less than T. And just looking at this definition, you may already imagine, what if we replace L1 with other metric? You can do LP, L in, or L infinity. And it turns out in our study, we found that Professor Plott's group, their construction of discrete fundamental group is in fact equivalent to using a similar notion, but replace L1 with L infinity. And I do have the slides to introduce Plott, Barostowski, and Wilkins' original construction of discrete fundamental group, but since you all have seen it, so I'm going to skip that part. And in the last page of my review of previous work, I want to mention some recent development of discretizing the homotopy groups. Richard, starting from, I believe his preprints was available in 2019, but it was recently published. He used the notion of check closure spaces to coarsen the continuity condition in the definition of standard homotopy. And along this line, very recently, Bubanik and Milachevic, they continue the idea of using check closure spaces to develop a uniform framework to impass the following notions. And so that's about the review. Let's now move on to the idea I mentioned. We want to lift discrete fundamental group to a persistent version. And this is simply done by defining this notion as p pi 1 as a functor that assign each t to the discrete fundamental group at scale t and assigns a pair of parameters to the induced group homomorphism from pi 1t to pi 1t prime. According to Wilkins' calculation of discrete fundamental group of S1, we immediately have the p pi 1 of S1 is the following. So within the interval 0 to 2 pi over 3, you see z everywhere. Outside of this interval, you obtain 0. And in our study, we found out that when T is a tree metric space, it always have a trivial persistent fundamental group.
Ling?
Yes.
In your definition of the persistent fundamental group, you are using pi 1T. And this is Professor Conlad's version or the other group version?
Professor Conlad's version.
Okay.
Yeah, but I imagine you can define a similar construction using the other version with no problem.
And are they equivalent?
They are not equivalent. As I mentioned, they differ in the definition, they differ by using L1 or L infinity. So, and that gives a difference. You can think, okay, so using Barcelos' work, you would see, for the example of S1, a bar that has length 0 to pi over 2. So, and in this example, it differs by scaling, but in general, I'm not totally sure about the relation.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, thanks for the question. Okay, so let's continue. And then, okay, so I started with lifting the discrete fundamental group, but for those who are familiar with persistence theory, you can immediately say, why don't we define persistent fundamental group by applying pi one on a filtration? And yes, we can do that. And there can be many different choices. For example, the popular Viotor-Ribbs filtration. And also there is a notion that's given by the Kuratowski embedding. So let me briefly introduce that. So we know that a metric space can be asymmetrically embedded into L infinity of this space X. And we can think of the T thickening of X within L infinity of X that gives an Kuratowski filtration. And we can apply pi one functor to these two types of filtration, the VR one and the Kuratowski one. And we get two new notions of persistent fundamental groups. It turns out these two new notions are in fact isomorphic to the one we got from discrete fundamental group. And this is due to Lim et al.'s work where they relate the Wiatr-Ribbs filtration with the Kwiatkowski filtration, and those are homotopy equivalent up to a scalar 2. And combined with the fact that fundamental group and edge pass groups of simplicial complexes are equivalent, furthermore, we obtain the following isomorphism between these three notions. So we came from a different path, but we end up with the same persistent fundamental group. And there's one property we often talk about, those persistent invariants, that is the stability. The reason for caring about stability is obvious, because we introduce an invariant. We want this invariant to be able to capture information about the space. Therefore, we want it to be when two spaces are close in a good sense, we also want the invariants to be close. And the way to measure whether the difference between metric spaces is the so-called Gromov-Hausdorff distance. And the way to measure the difference between persistent homotopy groups is the so-called interleaving distance. Here, from now on, I will drop my subscript because the three notions I introduced are all isomorphic. So, and I will denote p pi n to be a persistent n homotopy group. And for p pi n, we have the following stability result. In particular, when n equal to 1, we see that interleaving distance between pH 1 is less than or equal to interleaving between p pi 1, which both provide a lower bound for twice Gromov-Hausdorff distance. And just looking at this inequality, we immediately already see that p pi 1 would give us a better estimate than pH 1 in general. We will very soon see an example. But before that, I want to mention this inequality is not trivial in the sense that it cannot be very easily generalized to higher dimensions. In fact, to obtain this inequality, we need the fact that H1 is always a quotient group of pi 1. And this is true because H1 is the abelianization of pi 1. For higher dimensions, using the Hurwitz theorem, we can partially generalize this result in the sense that if we know the p pi r for r less than or equal to n are all zero, then for p pi r plus 1, we would see a similar result hold. Because using Hurwitz theorem, in pi r plus 1 in that case will be, sorry, h r plus 1 in that case will be a quotient group of pi r plus 1. So we can use a similar argument to obtain a partial generalization of this inequality. So now let's look at this example. We take the torus and the wedge sum of S2 with two copies of S1. This is an example often used to demonstrate that pi 1 contains more information than homology groups. So looking at these two spaces, we see that they have the same homology in all dimensions, but their pi 1 is different. And we expect the same phenomenon to happen in the persistent setting. And the answer is yes. Let me explain that. Let's first give some suitable metric to these two spaces. We equip the first one with the L infinity metric, the second one with the so-called gluing metric. Then in the paper by Admashik and Adams, they studied the Wiatr-Ribbs filtration of S1. In Lim et al.'s paper, they study using Kwiatkowski filtration, they study the homotopy type of Wiatr-Ribbs filtration of higher dimensional spheres. So combining their result, we obtain the following. Take A2 to be this constant, which is roughly 0.3 times pi, then restricted on this interval, the persistent homology of the two spaces are isomorphic in all dimensions. However, Restricted on this interval, their persistent fundamental group are different. In addition, this difference allows us to get an lower bound of the interleaving distance between p pi 1s, that is A2. And for the persistent homology, we also do not have a precise value, but we can estimate the interleaving distance to see that it will never be larger than this value, pi over 2 minus A2, and which turns out that the green value give us, the blue value give us a better estimate of the Grumhausdorf distance between these two spaces compared to the green value. So this is one of the evidence telling us p pi 1 can give us additional information than phn. Let's continue to the next thread, where we study a tree structure that arises from p pi 1. I want to start by introducing this notion of dendrogram. It's quite simple. By a dendrogram, you mean the following tree structure over a given set A. So this black lines is the dendrogram, and they form, they are given by a map that assigns each parameter to a partition of the underlining set. So for example, if you slide the dendrogram right here, you get a partition that clusters x1 and x2 and x3 and then x4. Carlson and Mamoli, they prove that there is a one-to-one correspondence between dendrograms and automatic spaces. So you can use these notions equivalently. Dendrogram structure comes in TDA in the following sense. In hierarchical clustering, where we consider how the connected components changes along the scale parameter. For example, consider this four-point metric space, where these values are the metrics between those points. When we increase the scale parameter, when it goes to one, we see that these two are clustered together, but the others are still isolated. As we keep increasing, we see that later on x3, x4 cluster together, and eventually they become into one cluster. And this gives us a tree structure or dendrogram for the persistent zeros homotopy group. And then we wonder, how about, does such a structure exist in p pi 1? Before that, I actually also put an example to show you that there exist spaces that have the same zero barcode, but their dendrogram structure on pi zero are different. This is an evidence that having this extra tree structure is interesting and give us additional information. And then the next question is whether such a structure exists for pi one, for p pi one. And we started to think of this question, and we want to think it in analogy to the dimension zero case. So that means we need to think of whether there is a way for us to cluster or identify different loops in pi one. So the structure would be that we have all of the homotopy classes in pi one, and we need to find a notion that allows us to cluster them along the scale parameter. And this is made possible by the following result proved in Wilkins' PhD thesis. The author proved that when X is a compact metric space satisfying a mild condition, then there exists a well-defined surjective Groom homomorphism from the standard pi 1 to pi 1 t. And here's the some condition that this Groom homomorphism phi t satisfied. But anyhow, the lemma is telling us that the discrete loops are in fact, the discretizations of the continuous loops in the space. So that allows us to imagine that such dendrogram structure would exist in Pi 1. In addition, on top of what Wilkin has done, we consider some additional condition on the space. With those assumptions, we prove that for T small, phi T is indeed an isomorphism. So this is telling us that with these assumptions, all of the continuous loops will actually last for at least a positive time and then start to merging to each other because of this existence of surjection from pi 1 to pi 1 t. This surjection allows us to view each pi 1 t as a partition of the standard pi 1. And in addition, it gives us the dendrogram structure on pi 1.
Ling?
Yes.
Can you see the previous slide?
Yes.
Can you tell me how much t should be small to make phi sub t becomes isomorphism?
That's a good question. In fact, with these assumptions, I do not have a uniform estimate of how small t is, but I'm not sure whether you still remember the notion of locally geometrically connected, the LGC. I remember you read that paper. Using that notion, yeah, we could give a better estimate of the size of t. Yeah, so I don't want to talk much about that part because many of the audience may not know what we are talking about. But what I want to convince you is that in certain cases, yes, we can get a good estimate of the size of T.
So the size of T should be upper bounded by some contractibility radius.
Yes, yes, that's true. Okay. One quick and simple example is when X is simply connected, then P pi 1 is trivial. As I mentioned, dendrogram is equivalent to ultramatrix spaces. So we can think of the ultramatrix space, the ultramatrix induced by the dendrogram structure on pi 1. And we prove a Gromov-Hausdorff stability for this ultramatrix on pi 1. That is given as follows. Then I want to move on to some more interesting examples. Come back to our example of S1. We have seen the P pi 1 of S1. Now let me introduce what the dendrogram looks for P pi 1. So the y-axis will represent the homotopy classes in of loops in pi 1. And we see that each bar starts from 0 and dies at 2 pi over 3. A slight more complicated example is when we have torus generated by circles of different sizes. We will be seeing the dendrogram looks like, so we have z many bars of length 2 pi over 3 r1 clustered at each integer here. And then they all together dies at 2 pi over 3 times the larger radius. And here I want to mention that this torus space and the wedge sum of spheres have the same first dimensional barcode, but their dendrogram structure over pi 1 are different. So in analogy to the pi 0 case. Now, coming back to our motivation question, how simply connected a space is, we can answer this question by checking the diameter of pi 1 equipped with the ultramatrix induced by the dendrogram structure. In the last part of this talk, I want to move on to talk about persistent rational homotopy. Why talking about rational homotopy? One obvious reason is because P pi n p pi n in general is difficult to compute, not saying in the computer, just theoretically, it's difficult to compute. For example, for S1, Admashik and Adams, they found out all the homotopy types of Vitor ribs of S1, and it turns out all spheres would appear in the closed version, and all dimensional spheres appear in the open version. However, homotopy groups of all spheres are not totally known, so this prevents us from computing p pi n of S1 for any n. And thus, we started to consider some other invariants that's easier to compute, but still contains more information. And this leads us to rational homotopy. It's computed by Seha in 1951, the rational homotopy groups of spheres. For odd spheres, pi n of the rational homotopy group is equal to q when n equal to the dimension of the sphere. So basically, this is the same as the homology group with rational coefficients. So it's not so much more interesting, but for even dimensional spheres, we are seeing something extra compared to the rational homology. That is, when n equal to 4k minus 1, pi n of sk tensored q is also equal to q. And then we use this standard result to compute the persistent rational homotopy for S1. Well, before that, we need to define the persistent rational homotopy, which you can imagine can be defined simply by tensoring p pi n with q. And this is only allowed when pi n is a billion, which is true when n is larger than or equal to 2. Well, it's not always true when n equal to 1. So if you care about n equal to 1, you will need to require all of the pi 1 appearing in p pi 1 are a billion. And coming back to the example of S1, we compute the persistent rational homotopy of S1. For the open version, it's equal to the persistent rational homology. But for the closed version, we see that persistent rational homotopy and persistent rational homology, they have a slight difference. That is, the former one is isomorphic to persistent rational homology plus this infinitely many q with at this 1 point interval for dimension n equal to 4k minus 1. For other dimensions, they still appear to be isomorphic. So this is not a very strong evidence saying that persistent rational homotopy is interesting. And a recent update, which I will share later, is that I will show you a more interesting example. Before that, I also want to mention the persistent rational homotopy is also stable. And in fact, the stability follows from the stability of persistent homotopy. If you want to talk about stability for p pi 1 tensor Q, you would require them to be abelian. Well, in that case, it's not so interesting because if they are abelian, then they would be the same as persistent homologies, pH 1. But anyhow, in general, we have this stability result. And now let's move on to this more interesting example. So it's similar to the torus and wedge sum of sphere, but we leave all of the dimensions of the spheres appearing in this example. We consider Sm cross Sm, and Sm wedge sum as 2m wedge sum Sm. And we consider m to be larger than or equal to 2, denote am to be this parameter. And again, by Lim et al.'s work, where they prove for any epsilon within this interval, I think I'm missing a scale. For any epsilon lying in this interval, the Vitor Ribs filtration of SM have the same homotopy type as SM itself. And here the two bullet point is to recall that for all N, the homology group of these two spaces are isomorphic, but their homotopy group or rational homotopy group are different. So for the product space, we are saying that take N equal to 3M minus 1, this rational homotopy group is 0. But following from Whitehead's study of homotopy group of wedge sum of spaces, we see that the rational homotopy group of the wedge sum space has at least rank 1. This, okay, here, let me emphasize. The choice of N equal to 3M minus 1 is done for M larger than or equal to 3. For M equal to 2, we can make a different choice, but we would still see a difference between the rational homotopy groups of the two spaces. And we combine these two bullet points together with Lim et al.'s work, we would obtain the persistent rational homotopy group of the two spaces restricted to this interval. And then combined with the stability of persistent rational homotopy, we obtain a lower bound for the Gromov-Hausdorff distance between these two spaces that is given by this value A2M, which appears to be a better estimate than persistent homology. So as before, we don't have a precise value because the homotopy type of Vitor-Ribb filtration of general spheres is not totally known. Well, we can still get an estimate and see that the green part is no larger than this value, which is less than A2M. So this gives us the evidence that using persistent rational homotopy, we get a better estimate compared to using persistent homology. And I have 2 minutes left. I do want to use the last 2 minutes to say something about the computational perspective, because I have given this talk several times before, and almost every time someone will ask, how do you compute it? That's a difficult question. And I want to share with you some results I found in the literature. For pi 1, we all know it's difficult to compute. Just checking whether fundamental group is trivial is already an undecidable question. I know there exist algorithm to find finite presentations of pi 1. And I also know there are references that use those finite presentations to get interesting invariants out of pi 1. So you can use those invariants to study p pi 1 and further study the underlying data set. For higher dimensional homotopies, there's more hope. So for either pi d or the rational pi d, when we fix a dimension, computing them can be done in poly time. And here are some references you can look at. There is a very old one by Brown in where he uses the Postonikov tower to compute the homotopy groups. And a recent one is by Kadig et al. They give an algorithm to compute pi d, and they give the complexity of the algorithm, which is polytime algorithm depending on d. And this would also give you an idea to believe that when we use d as an input, computing higher homotopy groups becomes NP-hard. Because when you fix a d, you see a polytime algorithm depending on D, but if you allow D to be your parameter, it's believable that the complexity goes to be NP-hard. And okay, so the summary is that if you care about computation, more hope lies in higher dimensions, persistent homotopy or persistent rational homotopy. And okay, it's the perfect time to stop. And any question and comments are welcome. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Ling, for the excellent talk. Let's all unmute and give a round of applause. Are there questions for Ling?
If there are no other questions, I have a question that's just maybe related to my own ignorance, but the metric D sub I that you mentioned earlier, and maybe it just went by too quickly, could you say more about that metric? How it's defined?
Sorry, metric D of I?
D sub I, yes. You had some inequalities involving the Gronhoff-Hausdorff metric earlier.
Ah, yeah, the interleaving distance, I see.
Yes.
Uh-huh. I see. So so about this interleaving distance, so here it is defined in general for any functors. And here our functors are functors from a poset category to the category of groups. And that interleaving distance captures the difference between two such functors in the sense that you can think there is a delta interleaving if you have commutative diagrams for. Okay, I think I was putting delta in the wrong place. So a delta interleaving will be natural transformations between the functor p pi n and p pi n x and p pi n y such that the natural transformation would induce commutative diagrams like this. Yeah, and you also go to the other side. You go from y to x, so you would actually require a pair of the natural transformation. So you have rho natural transformation and say tau. And this is not very precise, but because you will also need a shift by delta when you go from one to the other. And the interleaving distance is measuring the smallest, the infimum value of delta such that there exist these pairs of natural transformations between those functor up to a delta shift.
Mm-hmm. Lynn, can I make a quick comment here?
Yes.
So related to your talk, Conrad, I asked if there's sort of an analogy for this in the covering space setting. And so you pointed out that there's no isomorphism, right? There's no zero interleaving, you know, but maybe you could use delta to fudge over the critical points.
Yeah, let me clarify what I said. I mean, so if you actually fix epsilon, there is no, in general, isomorphism, but if you, but these groups are all eventually isomorphic, you know, depending on some other parameters, but you just have to fudge a little bit on the epsilon part. And so I don't fully understand this at the moment, but I mean, it seems like this is kind of related to that, yeah.
Ling, I had a question on your computability slide. So the thing you wrote in green, it was like Z plus, you know, Z mod P or different powers of P. That's the possible output of this rational homotopy groups for N at least two. Is that right?
This is the output for the standard homotopy group. So because all pi d are abelian, so and in the case, say for finite simplicial complexes, you would get a finally generated group, abelian group for pi d. So you can always write it in this form. For the rational, homotopy group, you will be getting the rank of the pi d, which would be simply the k.
So I see. Yeah. The rational part ignores the.
Yes. Yeah, that would be your output for rational homotopy.
I have one more question, and maybe this is a question for you and Conrad. So do we have something like a ciphered von Kampen theorem for persistent homotopy, or at least discrete homotopy? Analog of ciphered von Kampen theorem?
Sorry, what's that theorem?
Whenever X is a nice space, which is a union of U and V, and imagine your intersection V is a contractible space, then homotopy group of X is a join of a homotopy group of U and homotopy group of V. I think that is the easiest form of the ciphered von Kampen theorem.
So I will mention that my student Jay Wilkins did actually look into this, and so there are definitely theorems that one can prove these groups, and maybe Ling also has an answer.
Yeah, and I also think there's this group by Batten et al. They study a persistent version of Van Kampen theorem for persistent fundamental groups. I think they later updated their paper to add more results. Yeah, that's a good place to look for the answer to your question.
Thank you.
There are more questions for Lang? I had a quick question. I think was on slide 5, and it was also on your second to last slide.
Okay. Let me check the number, slide 5.
Yeah.
Okay, right here?
Maybe not. Oh, sorry. I think it's slide 10. I wrote down.
Okay. This example?
Yeah, I think I just missed this, but toward the bottom, this green inequality.
Yeah.
Could you say again, where is the pi over 2 minus a sub 2? Where's pi over 2 coming from again?
Yeah. So as I mentioned, we don't know the precise, we don't know this persistent homology precisely. So we can only get an estimate. What we know is that restricted to interval 0 to, okay, let me get a larger space, restricted from 0 to twice of A2, and I believe pi would be here, that the two PHNs, they are the same of the first space and the second space, they are the same. So the difference would come from the other part. You can just assume that they are different and to get an upper bound. So let me explain that. So if you were to get an interleaving, you can just, okay, so I should say, because after pi, all of the persistent homology becomes trivial, they become equal. So for the there always exists an interleaving of this length, pi minus twice of A2. Does that make sense? Because they are equal here and they are also equal after pi.
Yeah, I see.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so that's how the value comes. Yeah, thanks for the comment.
Mm-hmm. Are there more questions for Ling? Okay, well, thanks again for the great talk, Ling, and I'll go ahead and end the recording here.
Thank you.